I guess we'll start at the beginning and talk a little bit about the Digital Citizenship Institute, where it came from, who the founders.
This was like the early 2000s, and everybody was like focused on the tech.
Yeah.
And districts were going one to one, and the next district would be like, that town keeping up with the Joneses, they went one to one. We're going to go one to one. We're going to give, you know, devices to our third graders or our, you know, kindergartners.
Right.
And nobody had a plan.
Right.
And so I was the first faculty member on record that said, you know, we've got the cart before the horse. We need to lead with digital citizenship. And so I started to create courses. So I was the first faculty member to create an all 3-credit course. So one course ended up leading into another course that ended up into workshops and events. And then ultimately, in the fall of 2015, we hosted the first Digital Citizenship Summit. It was a conference. So on my college campus, we could only hold 220 people.
Okay.
But we had a live stream audience, and we were trending number one. So that's when I was like, aha, we have like struck a nerve. People
yeah.
are hungry to be a part of this conversation. We've been all around the world working with communities. Putting on these summits, and then also working with school communities in industry and government to change that narrative from the reactive to the proactive.
And what attracted me was the story you just heard, her passion to want to change the narrative, and that digital citizenship is everyone's responsibility. So we work with schools all around the world, but what's great is when we get into a community, we went into a school district, we understand the community is much larger. So we touch with parent. We have touch points with parents. We work with businesses and industry and government bodies, and it's wonderful because we're, like she said, we're really trying to change the narrative that digital citizenship is everyone's voice needs to be heard.
Well, it seems like a very a daunting task
that
you've put in front of yourselves. Where do you start with something like that?
Well, I feel like it's a community approach no matter
Correct.
Where we are.
Correct.
So, you know, we work with schools. Like, we've got a school district in upstate New York that we're going to be working with. And it is going to be the educators, the students, and the parents. And it will be that community approach so that the same message is happening in school as it is at home.
So what we did in Malaysia is we worked with the Human Resource Department because they came to us and said, we want to hold classes for adults on digital citizenship. Can you help us create a course, work with our teachers, and then can you help oversee the coursework? And then will you be able to help us be certified so where we can run 1,000 teachers or 1,000 adults through the course? But when we go somewhere, we work with the local culture and people in the industry over there to make it so we're not taking a Western culture to Asia. What we're doing is we're taking digital citizenship, which is global.
Are there commonalities across those cultures when it comes to digital citizenship?
You know, okay, so I have an 11-year-old, and last July, he's actually presenting right now at ISTE, but we went to Nigeria. We both were interviewed, and he surprised me with his response because someone wanted to ask, what do you see? You know, an 11-year-old doesn't get to travel the way that you get to travel.
Right.
What would be your big take? And he was like, well, there's a lot of fear in the United States. When we travel internationally, there's less fear.
A smile's universal. Everybody enjoys a smile, no matter what language, what country, what culture. Digital citizenship is the same thing. And with our travels all over the world, we see that common ground with everyone. We call it a human quality. We all enjoy that feeling. Now, the next thing is the local flavor. When we were in Dublin just a month ago, they were really looking at access for all and not just like global internet access. They're talking like wheelchairs, people wheelchair accessible, braille for the blind, different things. How do people with disabilities have access to digital citizenship? What does it look like for
right.
them?
What would you say is the biggest surprise that you've had on your journey?
I think that the number one is there's still a lot of fear and the scare tactics. And I think some organizations continue to add to that. The media adds to that.
And so now we're even reaching out and we've had emerging tech companies come to us and want to talk to us about what that looks like. And so we're starting to work with them because think about this, the whole thing of virtual reality. We now have another space where people can live, socialize, be, and choose to be in. So what does digital citizenship look like in there?
Talk a little bit about how important it is to have a wider community beyond just the student. I'll assume that I mean, digital citizenship is kind of for everyone, right? I mean,
it's yeah, not, it's everybody's not just responsibility. Yeah. Right. It's everybody's mm-hmm. responsibility. And I go with my son and we do professional development and we'll talk about, I'll ask to the audience, who here uses their cell phone as an alarm clock? And like all the adults, all these hands go up. Yeah. And I'll say, I want to welcome you back to the human race. I want you to go back and get that old fashioned alarm clock because, it's our responsibility as adults to model this. And so if I'm always saying good morning and good night to my device, then I'm sending a message to
where I tell my kids to stop looking at their screen while I'm looking at my screen.
Right. Yeah. So it's just like, the adults, whether it's going to be our educators or our parents or, in the industry, I feel like I'm having this conversation, whether I'm at Dunkin' Donuts getting, or I'm at this bus stop, wherever I am, I'm trying to engage. Like, I'll go to a Red Sox game. Right. I'll say to my son, we're going device free. And he'll go,
we don't have a don't do this, do this. We have an I will kind of philosophy.
Gotcha.
Like, I will be thoughtful, I will be proactive, things like that. We're not saying get rid of devices, they're not going anywhere. We know that.
Right.
I use them, she uses them, you use them.
Right.
It's just like,
how can we be more mindful and deliberate, that when we're plugged in? And how can we have that balancing act?
So 5 years from now, will the Institute still be necessary?
So that's a great question. I love that. Yeah. It'll still be around, but what we'll be doing might be slightly changed. Because, emerging tech, it's funny with all the, the AR, VR, MR, AI, ML, artificial intelligence, machine learning and stuff. It's a fascinating realm, which I live in very much so. And that's when we kind of combine. So what we're trying to do is always be on the forefront of what's 12 months, what's 5 years? How does that play back to digital citizenship? How will that affect our human behavior? We call it digital overlap. It's when human behavior is interacting with, digital content by choice. We're choosing and it's altering our behavior.
Well, I'll stop with a great question.
That was good.
That's great. That's wonderful.
That was really good.